Joining me now from San Antonio, Texas, Middle East history professor David Lesh. He is the author of two books on the Assad family, and he has met multiple times with Bashar al-Assad. Professor, nice to see you. Welcome.
Thank you.
If you could guess, sir, do you think Bashar al-Assad is celebrating today or breathing a sigh of relief that the U.S. has put off action against him?
I think he's sighing a little breath of relief. But I think overall, they've already made the calculation that anything the U.S. would do in terms of a strike, whether now or later, wasn't going to change dramatically the scope of things on the battlefield. I think they've already made the determination that the United States, the Obama administration, is not out to affect regime change, as the Obama administration has said right up front. And numerous times, the Syrian regime obviously has come up against or exceeded the so-called red lines. And so I think they feel fairly certain that below a certain level of force, that they can do what they want in terms of taking action against the revolutionaries.
So a sigh of relief from the president in Syria. I want to take you back, David, to last Friday. Military action against Syria at the time seemed a near certainty, even imminent. So I was talking to one of our CNN analysts, former CIA operative Bob Baer, and he told me this. I want to play this soundbite for you. This is based upon conversations he had with his contacts in Damascus.
And this regime is panicking. And they've made it very clear that if any of these strikes look like regime change, if they hit, for instance, the 4th Division, the president's brother's division, Bashar al-Assad will act irrationally. And that could mean anything you could imagine, from attacking neighboring countries to using more gas.
Panicking, irrational, David Lesh. Again, that was my interview last Friday, but when the regime appeared to be under that imminent threat of attack, the crux there being that Assad might act irrationally. As we mentioned, you've met the man a couple of times. Proper assessment? Unstable?
I wouldn't describe it like that. They weren't panicking. I can almost assure you of that. They're used to this. Again, they're fairly certain that the United States was going to act in a very limited way. The United States was actually saying it was going to act in a limited way. They know the United States doesn't want to affect regime change. If anything, they were trying to figure out how they would respond, not so much in a dramatic fashion or any meaningful sort of way against the U.S. or U.S. interests, but how do we turn this to our favor in terms of propaganda? You know, how do we make it fit the narrative that they've been saying from the very beginning, that the whole uprising is caused by external enemies of Syria? And, you know, how do we portray ourselves as the victim of an American-Israeli project, which, again, for Assad, has won him a lot of points in the Arab world, particularly a lot of street credibility in the Arab world in recent years?
So street cred from some, considered a despot by, we heard from John Kerry on Friday, and when I think of Middle East despots, we think of the one who set the modern standard. It was this guy. It was Iraq's Saddam Hussein. He seemed to relish playing the bad guy. Side by side with Saddam, Bashar al-Assad, strictly by appearances, seems to be milder. I read an article you wrote, you know, that I guess when you first met him in 2004, you let the world know this man loves Phil Collins. You called him a geek. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean, and that's why people had a lot of hope in Bashar al-Assad when he came to power, because he was different, because he was had the atypical background and atypical personality of your usual Middle East tyrant. And people, you know, thought that he would bring a dramatic reform into Syria. But what people didn't realize is that, you know, Syria is almost immune to dramatic reform because of the inert, stagnant system that he inherited. And so I think the expectations of him in Syria, and particularly outside of Syria in the United States, were way too high, and therefore the disappointment was that much greater. You know, just because he likes Western rock music doesn't mean he's going to embrace the West and embrace Israel. I mean, the major influences on his life were his father. You know, he was a child of his father. He was a child of the Arab-Israeli conflict. He was a child of the superpower Cold War. This had a great deal more impact on his worldview than spending 18 months in London studying ophthalmology.
I just take a look at the Assad family photo. So here you have Hafez. This is Bashar, his father, predecessor. And then standing left to right, that is Maher, Bashar, and Basil. And we are all led to believe that Bashar was not his father's first choice to succeed him. Tell me about that, David.
Well, Basil was the first to succeed. Everyone believes that to be the case until he died in a car accident in 1994. And as is usual in the Arab world, when the second eldest son then sort of takes over or is groomed for the family business, and that's what Bashar was in the mid to late 1990s. He was elevated in the state apparatus in a number of ways, very, very quickly, and almost a race against time to build a credible base of power before his father, who was in ill health, died in 2000.
And Michael, let's throw the picture back up, because I want to talk more about the brother Maher Assad. Maher Assad commands Syria's ruthless 4th Army Division, accused of orchestrating that August 21st chemical weapons attack. And there are rebels who believe it is Maher in charge and Bashar is more of a figurehead. Professor, is there any truth to that?
Not to my knowledge. And my understanding of the situation, many Syrians to whom I've spoken who were either recently in the Syrian government or still in the Syrian government universally say that Bashar al-Assad is in control. He's the one that's calling the shots. And I think this counters the dominant image of Bashar over the years. And he was thought of as fairly weak and incompetent by most governments. And what's interesting is that in talking to high-level government officials in countries in the Middle East in recent months, they've told me, you know, now they almost have a grudging respect for him, certainly not a like for him, but a grudging respect, that they've changed their profile of him, that he's a lot tougher guy to deal with than they had first thought.
And we talked earlier about Saddam Hussein. We know he had palaces all over the place, some or all of which were also military command centers, and he had this network of underground bunkers impervious to attack. Do you know if Bashar al-Assad has that same kind of infrastructure as well in Syria?
I don't know for sure, but I assume they have something akin to that. The Syrian regime is somewhat paranoid to the outside world, but I don't think to the case that Saddam Hussein was, especially Saddam Hussein, who was attacked on numerous occasions by the West. But I assume there is something there, particularly because they are, you know, they've been confronting Israel, or they've seen to be, they see themselves as having confronted Israel for decades. And therefore, they've made preparations mostly against Israel and Israeli attacks. So I assume there is something there, and they've made arrangements to protect themselves should there be a U.S. strike.
And speaking of a U.S. strike, just bringing this all back to Washington, we know right now the president's meeting with Senators Graham and McCain, and in Washington's really in a holding pattern right now as far as any kind of military action. As the U.S. debates this, do you see any possibility that Bashar al-Assad might stage another chemical weapons strike?
That would be even more foolish than the initial one if, in fact, they did carry that out. I can't imagine anything like this happening, especially when they, in their view, see the United States and the world community equivocating somewhat, giving them a bit of a respite. Why would they do anything that would generate more heat on them than already exists? So I don't see anything happening. Now, you know, if the U.S. does strike at some point, you know, the question will be, will it affect a change of behavior? Certainly not a change of regime, but a change of behavior. And then we'll see.
What do you think?
That point.
What do you think?
I think, again, there's, you know, the Bashar al-Assad regime is doing things in a very calibrated way. You know, it's a calibrated way of bloodshed, enough to do the job and protect the regime and to defeat the rebels, but not enough to bring down the wrath of the world community. And so far, they've really been treading, right at that line and crossing it. So I suspect they may draw back a little bit from that, at least for a time, and concentrate on their most immediate problems.
David Lesh, thank you so much for your insight, having met this man multiple times, Professor Middle East Studies. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.